choir makes their way down, let's look at our scripture verse for this morning. It's taken from Matthew chapter 13, verses 53 through 58. If you have your Bibles and want to follow along, I'll be reading from the New International Version, Matthew 13, verses 53 through 58. Mine has a title that says, A Prophet Without Honor. When Jesus had finished these parables, he moved on from there. Coming to his hometown, he began teaching the people in their synagogue, and they were amazed. Where did this man get this wisdom and these miraculous powers? They asked. Isn't this the carpenter's son? Isn't his mother's name Mary? And aren't his brothers James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas? Aren't all his sisters here with us? Where did this man get all these things? And they took offense at him. And let me tell you the way we would say that today. We would say it this way. If we were those people, we would speak it like this. We would say, where does he get off preaching at us like that? Who does he think he is? Do you see that? Who does he think he is? I mean, we watched him grow up from the time he was a kid. That's what they're saying. And then Jesus said this, only in his hometown and in his own house is a prophet without honor. And he did not do many miracles there because of their lack of faith. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the power of your word. We thank you for the truth. Father, we know that in you is life. And we this morning give you all honor and glory and praise because you are worthy. And as the choir has sung for us this morning, all of life, everything we really need is wrapped up in knowing you. The world tries to tell us different, but the truth really will set us free. We thank you, Father, for your great love, your great mercy, your great compassion on your people. And we pray that you will open our ears this morning to hear the truth, to hear you speak through our pastor, to bring your words. We give you praise and honor and glory. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, brother. Young man in his early 20s, dressed in overalls and a dirty sweater, knee-high rubber boots, walked into a car dealership, a new car dealership in Norway, just above the Arctic Circle. He approached a salesman, the first person that he saw, and he told him that he had come to purchase 16 new cars. The salesman laughed and said he didn't have time for jokes. He had to sell cars. He said, go and bother someone else. So the young man did. He went across the street to another car dealership. and he purchased 16 brand new cars, and he paid cash for all of them. That young man was part of a 16-member commercial fishing group that had just caught the greatest catch of their lives. And doubting the truthfulness of that young man cost that car salesman a great deal of money. Might have even cost him his job. Doubting the truthfulness of the gospel of Jesus Christ cost much, much more. We just completed a study through the great parables of Matthew 13. This morning, Matthew will reveal to us the great tragedy of unbelief. The great tragedy of rejecting Jesus Christ. Rejecting the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ is simply the greatest mistake anyone can possibly ever make. Passing up an opportunity to receive Christ as Savior and Lord of your life is a mistake. A great mistake, very possibly an eternal mistake. Because sometimes we get no second chance, or third, or 50th. So what can we learn about the tragedy of unbelief from this passage of Scripture this morning? We're going to look at three truths that can alert us to the danger of doubt. So first, let's look at the sin of assumption. The sin of assumption. Look at verses 53 through 56. Now it came to pass when Jesus had finished these parables that he departed from there. When he had come to his own country, he taught them in their synagogue, so that they were astonished and said, "Where did this man get this wisdom and these mighty works? Is this not the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary, and his brothers James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas? And his sisters, are they not all with us? Where then did this man get all these things?" So get the picture. Jesus had just finished sharing some of the great parables recorded in Matthew's gospel. In fact, Matthew's the only gospel writer that records these particular parables. And then now, suddenly and very interestingly, we find that Jesus made a visit to his hometown. We know from the Christmas story, Jesus was born in Bethlehem, but he grew up in Nazareth. We know, the world knows Jesus as Jesus of Nazareth. Now, this passage is also found in Mark's gospel, and it's also found in Luke's gospel, although some scholars say Luke's account is not the same account. Some scholars say that's another visit that Luke records because it's so different from Mark and Matthew. Mark's gospel provides some very important information that neither Matthew nor Luke include. For example, Mark 6 and verse 1. There the Bible says, Jesus left and returned to his hometown. That's basically what Matthew's saying. But then Mark adds three very important words. Mark says, with his disciples. So Mark tells us that Jesus didn't just go home, he took his disciples with him. So get the picture. Immediately after schooling his disciples through these incredible parables, he took them to the school of hard knocks. You ever been to the school of hard knocks? Yeah, we've all been to the school of hard knocks. Some of us have doctorate degrees from the school of hard knocks. So here's what happened. They followed him 20 miles, which was a long way. 20 miles over the mountains from Capernaum to Nazareth. So why? Why did Jesus want to go home, and why did he want to go home then? Why did his disciples go with him? Maybe Jesus wanted to go home to just escape the crowds. Maybe he wanted to go home to get some peace and quiet. I went home last weekend, and it was nice. Just going home and visiting with my parents, spending some time with my parents, it was precious, and it was refreshing, and it was nice. Maybe Jesus just wanted to go home and spend some time where he grew up, the place where he spent most of his 30 years. Maybe he wanted to go and tell his friends and his family how they too could enter the kingdom of God. You know, it's a funny thing to go home again. Some years back, Tina and I decided to drive through the neighborhoods in the Atlanta metro area where we grew up. It's kind of funny, kind of amazing. And this goes way over my head, and if I'm wrong, I'm sorry. But there's this software called Google Earth. Anyone ever heard of that? You know, I was sitting at the house the other day, and I went on the top of Mount Everest. I went to the Great Wall of China. I went to Stonehenge. I've always heard of that. I wanted to see what it looked like, just some rocks. I went to Stone Mountain. I even went to my high school where I graduated high school, McEachern High School, because I know that area. And I could see the M on the football field. I'm sitting there in my living room thinking, if I can see this, what can the Army guys see? Anyway, had nothing to do with where we're going. That's a cool thing. Google Earth is really, wow. But it's not the same as driving down the road. It's just not the same as putting boots on the ground, as driving down the road where you grew up. Tina and I saw what my friends and I knew as Dead Man's Curve. It's funny, it wasn't nearly as sharp as I remembered it when I was growing up. We came around the corner and we went down the big hill. It wasn't nearly as steep as I remembered it to be. It seemed funny visiting those places that were so familiar 40 years ago. It's funny how the passing of time changes our perspective of things. Well, not much time had passed since Jesus was living in Nazareth. And since that time, he had begun his public ministry. Since that time, he had revealed his deity. And his perspective of his community had not changed. But his community's perspective of him had changed. Verse 54 says, when the people heard him teach, they were astonished. The word for astonished means greatly amazed or overwhelmed. They were blown away. And apparently with his teaching, Jesus performed some miracles, a few miracles. And the people said, where did this man get this wisdom and these mighty works? They were blown away with what he did, what he said. I mean, this was Jesus, Joseph's boy, the carpenter. And they knew him. Like Richard said, they knew him. They knew his family. They knew his mother and his brothers and his sisters. They knew Jesus since he was knee-high to a grasshopper. And yeah, he was a good kid. He always was a good kid. They couldn't ever think of anything he did really wrong. But they knew him as an uneducated, ordinary guy who made his living with his hands. They knew him. At least they thought they did. at least they assumed that they knew him. How many marriages have been destroyed by false assumptions? How many relationships have been destroyed by false assumptions? Many. That's what's happening here. Their assumptions were wrong. Their presuppositions were misguided. They thought they knew Jesus. So they questioned the source of his message, and they ultimately rejected him because they thought they knew him. And they based their rejection upon false assumptions. That, you see, they couldn't explain him, so they rejected him. We've got a saying for that. We call that judging a book by its cover. God calls that sin. Well, secondly, let's look at a prophet without honor. Verse 57. So they were offended at him. But Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor except in his own country and in his own house. In response to their rejection, Jesus made a very important, a very interesting statement. Jesus referred to himself as a prophet. That's important. When we think about a prophet, we think Old Testament. We think of someone who foretells the future. And that's right, but that's not exactly technically what a prophet does. A prophet is someone who speaks for God. Of course, a true prophet speaks God's truth. So what he says will always come true because God's truth will always come to pass. But you may be thinking, well, of course Jesus was a prophet. He's God. Of course he was a prophet. And that's obviously true, but what's significant here is who called him a prophet? He called himself a prophet. He referred to himself as a prophet. He was speaking truth. And he used a common proverb of the day. That is, a prophet receives honor except in his hometown and except around his own family. You may have found that to be true in your own experience. I have. Many times, the hardest people to reach for Christ are the people closest to us. Many times the hardest people to reach are the people closest to us. People that have known us a long, long time sometimes have difficulty believing because of false assumptions or misguided suppositions about us. You see, people who know us well or have known us for a long time tend to identify themselves with us. Just follow me here. People tend to transpose their own shortcomings and their own limitations to us. And they may think, they may even say, according to what neighborhood you're from or what family you're from, you can't have that joy that you claim. You can't have that peace that you profess because I grew up in the same neighborhood with you. Or I grew up in the same house with you. And I struggle with the same things with which you struggled. And I don't have that joy or that peace, therefore you can't either. We came from the same place, and I don't have what you claim, therefore what you claim is invalid. And they just brush us off. False assumptions. Let me remind you this morning. A prophet does not draw their authority from the ones to whom they are prophesying. A prophet draws their authority from the one for which they are prophesying. There's a big difference. Jesus didn't come home to get approval from the homeboys. He didn't go to Nazareth to get a pat on the back. He didn't go to get encouragement from his homeboys. He went home to tell them how they could enter the kingdom of God. He went home because he had the gospel and he had the responsibility to share it, and he was a prophet without honor, just like he said. But lastly, there's the tragedy of unbelief, verse 58. Now, he did not do many mighty works there because of their unbelief. That's powerful. Now, he did not do many mighty works there. Listen to Mark chapter 6 and verse 5. Now, he could do no mighty work there except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them. That's Mark's account. The word for works in verse 58 is dunamis. It means power. We get our word dynamite from that particular word. And here it refers to the mighty works of power that had made Jesus so famous and so popular everywhere he went. Yet Jesus could do no miracles at home except to heal a few sick people. Now, that doesn't mean that Jesus couldn't do miracles like he did at Capernaum. You and I know Jesus could have healed everyone there. But he didn't. And the Bible tells us why he didn't. He didn't because of their unbelief. In fact, Mark 6:6 says he marveled at their unbelief. Did you know that Jesus only marveled twice in the Bible? He only marveled twice in the Bible. And both times were in response to faith. Once was in response to the great faith of a Gentile centurion, Matthew 8 and verse 10. And the other time was in response to the great lack of faith by Jews in his hometown in Mark 6:6. He marveled at their unbelief. He marveled at how they could not believe. How could you not believe? He marveled at that. And because of their unbelief, he performed no miracles except for healing a few people. Again, were those people beyond his help? No. He could have emptied all the hospitals. Listen, he could have emptied all the graveyards. He could have made everyone there to be a follower of him. But that's not how God works. Let me tell you something. God gives us a free will. Every one of us, we have a free will. God doesn't make us trust him. That's our choice. We all make choices. And one choice we make, the most important choice we make, is what we will do with Jesus. Revelation 3 and verse 20 says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and dine with him, and he with me." You see, God will knock on your door. In fact, guess what? He's doing that right now. By virtue of your being here in church this morning, he's giving us an opportunity to come to him. How precious is that? One day we'll know just how precious that is. God will knock on the door of our heart, but he will not break it down. We have a choice we must make. And that door has only one handle and only one lock and only one key. And the handle and the lock and the key are all on our side of the door. They're all on our side of the door. And the key that opens the door of our heart to God is faith. That's what faith is. Faith is the key that unlocks our heart to God. And the people at Nazareth chose not to use that key. Many people die every day who made the choice not to use that key. But it's their choice. Faith is the key to accepting the grace of God's salvation. But listen, Christian. Not only does faith lead to salvation, faith leads to peace and joy and all of the things that we want in life. Listen, a Christian who loves their life apart from walking in faith, a Christian who loves themselves and just happy as they can be with themselves, apart from faith in Christ, is walking by sight. A person who is a professor of salvation in Jesus Christ, who walks according to their own knowledge and according to their own power, is cheating themselves. It's like going through life with $1 million in the bank and eating out of a garbage can. Not only is it tragic, it doesn't make any sense. To be perfectly honest with you, that's where some of us are this morning. We're saved, but we're not living like it. Then we wonder why we're never really happy, or we don't have that joy that we desire. It comes from giving up and turning our lives over to Christ. In just a few moments, we're going to commission our mission team that will be leaving this week for Brimfield, Massachusetts. I've been doing a little research. I can't help myself. According to what I've found, there are 449 congregations in Greenville County, South Carolina. And 57% of the total population of our county attends church. 57%. Now, Brimfield, Massachusetts is in Hampton County, Massachusetts. And in that county, there are 247 congregations. 81% of them are Catholic. So you can do the math. About 50-something are non-Catholic. And that includes, according to these statistics, Jehovah's Witnesses, Mormon Church, any other than Catholic. Christian and non-Christian, any congregation. Yet 65% of that county, of the population of that county, is in church. They have a higher rate in Brimfield, Massachusetts, of church attendance than we have here. Isn't that interesting? Here's the important thing. The gospel of Jesus Christ is not as accessible in Brimfield as it is in Greenville. Maybe more people are going to church, but the gospel of Jesus Christ is not as accessible there as it is here. But the need is just as great. The need is just as great. So yes, people from here need to go there. and share the hope of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that's what's happening, and that's why we're going. We need to pray for our mission team, and we're going to do that in just a few moments. We need to pray that the people of Brimfield make the choice to use the key of faith to open their hearts to God. We need to pray that the people of Greenville use the key of faith to open their hearts to God. We need to pray that hearts are open to God even here, even right now. We need to pray that if there's someone here that's never prayed to receive Jesus, that today becomes the day of salvation. We need to pray that if there's that one that's saved but it's living like they're lost, today's the day to come home. Today's the day for rededication. We need to pray for commitment, recommitment, and transparency, honesty today. Let's pray together. Father, search our hearts. Allow us, O God, even just for a moment, to see us as you see us. And by the power of your Holy Spirit, God, we pray that you would draw us to you. Father, for those of us, Father, we lift up Patty to you now. Pray, God, that you'd be so near to her. Lord, just draw her near to you. We pray for healing and strength. We pray for wisdom. We thank you, God, for blessing us, glorifying your name through her. Now give her strength. Lord, speak to our hearts. Draw us near. In Christ's name we pray. You've heard the invitation. You're here today and you've never given your heart to Jesus. Do that right now. Don't wait. You come. Now maybe you are a Christian and you know it, but you also know that you haven't been living for the Lord. You come. Rededicate your life. You come. However God is calling, you come. And just be honest. Richard, lead us in him. Blue's going to tell us about the mission trip and the commission this time.
As Barry mentioned, we're going to Brimfield, Massachusetts. And it's about a little over an hour west of Boston. And we're helping a small, tiny church in a small, tiny town called Friendship Baptist Church. Their pastor works at the association there, and he also works at the church. And just really looking forward to go and come alongside them to help them share the gospel with their community and serve their community. There's two ways that at least two ways. Now, the pastor told me to be flexible because there may be other ways, but where we're going to kind of come alongside them and help. They were able to purchase a old home. The home's it's over 200 years old that they have already begun renovating. Hopefully, we're coming in to do some finishing work on it. And the pastor's going to live in that home, and it also has space to host groups like ours. And also a place for them to have meetings and things like that. So some of our folks will be helping in that way. They've also scheduled for us to work in an apartment complex to minister to families and to children. They have, I believe he said, 64 children that live in those apartments. And so we're going to be doing kind of a relational backyard Bible club, VBS kind of deal, where we'll be teaching, playing games, doing crafts, and just whatever we can to build relationships that hopefully allow the church to connect with these people on an ongoing basis for the months and even the years to come. In talking to the pastor, Steve, he told me, listen, you've got to be prepared to know that these children have absolutely no knowledge of who Jesus is. So like when we do VBS, typically we have the same kids that come every year. We can kind of make some assumptions about who they are and what they already know. But with them, we're going to be starting with, there is a God who created and who loves. And so very basics, very tough ground. And so pray for us and pray for this ministry. Romans 10:14 says, how then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? Some of these children and families haven't heard. And how shall they hear without a preacher, without someone telling them? And how shall they preach unless they are sent? So I want to thank you, Northgate, for sending this group to go. And I'm going to ask them to come forward now. Mission team, you can come forward and come to the front. And another member of our mission team is Porter Husky. Porter, you can come forward. Porter will be driving us this week. And so we're thankful for that. And I believe if my count is correct, we have about 20. Here's one of these pillows, nice and comfy. I believe by last count, I think we had 28 people going. And it's really neat, and it's going to be a lot of fun. And we look forward to serving. Just so you'll know, on Friday and Saturday, we'll be traveling. Sunday, we'll be at worship with them and then fellowshipping with them that day. Monday, we'll be working and serving. Tuesday, we'll be working and serving. Wednesday, we will be having a 4th of July kind of festivities at the apartment complex where parents will be there, and it'll be a lot of fun just to connect with them. And then on Thursday, we'll be doing the same type of work. And then on Friday, we're doing a little sightseeing in Boston. So we look forward to that. So please pray for us. As you leave today, I believe there's cards that we'll give you a way that you can pray for us. And I'm going to ask Richard to commission us through prayer.
Okay, this will be our prayer of commission for this group and also a benediction. So let's pray. Father, you have told us in your word that we are to go and to tell. But Father, we first must live the life that you have laid before us. And that is what these standing here this morning have done. They've been living their lives following your lead, allowing you to live through them. And now you have laid it on their hearts to follow this great commission and this mission work that you have for them. And so, Father, we pray, first of all, for protection. We ask you to let your angels guard over them and watch over them as they step forward in this mission. And then, Father, we pray that you will give them power. Your word has promised that you would do that, that you have given them your spirit through Jesus Christ. So, Father, as they go into this neighborhood, let the people there see Jesus in each of them. And Father, I pray that Jesus will love on those people through each of these standing here this morning, and that they will give their hearts to you totally and completely. Father, strengthen those that are waiting them for them there to help them with this mission, who've laid the groundwork. We pray that you would strengthen them and encourage them. And Father, we look forward to what you will tell us that you have done as each of these that come back tell us the stories of what you do through them. Father, we thank you and we praise you in advance for what you're going to do, because your word will not return to you void. And we thank you for that. Father, I pray that you will speak mightily, and that it will stir the hearts of each of these that have committed to do this in such a way that, Father, they can't wait to the next thing that you have for them. Father, I pray that as we stay behind, that each of us that are here would continue daily to pray for each one of these and pray for them by name, and that we would lift them up to you, and that you would strengthen them, Father, and strengthen us because of what we are doing for you as well. Let us lift up mighty prayers, daily prayers, for each of these. Father, we thank you and we praise you for who you are and what you will do. Go with us from this place, Father. Guide us in all that we do in our neighborhoods. Let your light shine through us. In Jesus we pray. Amen.